So we will start our session of the instrument design. In laparoscopy, there are five sets of instruments. One is hand instrument, other is optical instrument, third is insufflating instrument, fourth is light emitting instrument, and fifth is energy sources. So one by one, I will discuss all the instruments. The first today, I am demonstrating you the hand instrument. In hand instrument, there are two sets. One is reusable, other is disposable. So first we will have a look of the reusable instrument, then we will discuss the disposable instrument. For every instrument, we should have five information. First information, what is the name and the name of the different part of the instrument. Second information you should have, that what are the usage of the instrument. Third information, what are the complications this instrument can do? Fourth is, what is the alternative? If this instrument is not there, what alternative we can use? And fifth is, how to clean and sterilize that instrument. So every instrument we have to learn these five important information. Now the first instrument which I am discussing is, this is called as Verres needle. Verres needle was actually invented by a physician whose name was Verres. He has invented this needle for pleural aspiration. So there is a spring action here. And it has two parts. This is called as needle. This is needle and this is a stylet. And this needle doesn't have any job except pricking it. Except pricking the layers. The main function is a stylet, which has a valve. If it is at right angle, that means it is closed. And if it is parallel, that means it is open. And it has one spring, so that, and tip is blunt. Tip is blunt, it will not pierce. And there is one opening on the side. It is not at a tip to take the air out. So when you will put the needle, this spring action will keep the blunt tip in front. So the idea is, when it will enter into the abdominal cavity, then immediately this blunt tip will go in front and it will not perforate the bowel. The Verres needle is available in four length, 8 cm, 10 cm, 12 cm and 20 cm. 8 cm is used for pediatric patient, 10 and 12 is used for adult, and 20 cm is used for bariatric patient, for morbid obesity. It is very interesting to know these are the different length of them. It is very interesting to know that Verres needle is a controversial instrument. If you will go to any conference or debate, then they say that open technique is better. Hassan technique, that is open technique, is better. Verres needle technique is not good. But maximally used access is the Verres needle only. People, they speak against the Verres needle, but they use it. 80% of all the gynecologists, they use Verres needle. And 60% of the surgeon, they use Verres needle. Gynecologists generally, they don't like Hassan technique. Because it is time taking. Layer by layer you have to open. And most of the many cases, once it is multi-para patient, or if it is little lax abdomen, then going Verres needle is not difficult. If you will compare the Verres needle and blind trocar insertion. Then some gynecologists, they directly put the trocar, blind trocar insertion, without creating pneumopatorium. Especially in India, if you will see the tubalization camps in the remote area, in the village, in the block level, in one day they have to perform 50 to 100 surgery. So they not use various needle. They directly give the incision 11 mm, lift the abdominal wall and direct trocar insertion. Directly they put the trocar. So it's a computer view also. And blind trocar insertion, some people they say that it is safe. But, and they say that it is less injury than the varicidal. And they are true. The blind trocar create less injury than the varicidal because varicidal is more fine, more thin. But one thing they don't tell, that 75% of all the injury by the varicidal goes unnoticed. Whereas any other trocar injury will not go unnoticed, is reflected into complication. When you put varicidal, many a time it will rupture the bowel. But we don't know also that it occurs. Because if it comes out, it seals spontaneously, no problem. So that's why varicidal you should use, or open technique you should use. Blind trocar insertion should be avoided. Blind trocar insertion, sharp trocar without creating pneumopatonium, is a bad technique. Varicidal is also very much useful in cases of bariatric surgery. In bariatric surgery, open technique is very difficult because the fat is so thick in between the anterior rectus and skin that holding the anterior rectus is very difficult. So generally, varicidal technique is used. Sometime if around the abdomen if you have adhesion, then you can go with the palmer's point. Varicidal should be held in your hand like a dart. This is the way to hold the varicidal. Like a dart. The dart is a game which is used to just like an arrow to you throw over the board to aim it. It should be held like a dart. And direction of the varicidal should be towards the anus. It should not be perpendicular. And patient head should be 15 degrees down. That is called as tender and bird position. But there is one problem. Problem is that if you will go oblique, here this is one click and this is second click, you are in. But sometime what happens, your tip of the varicidal will slide over the peritoneum or fat. Then you will make a pre-peritoneal pocket. So one of the great disadvantages of going towards the anus or going oblique is creation of the pre-peritoneal insufflation. If you will go perpendicular, this problem will not happen. It will not slide, it will puncture. One clip, second clip, it will go in. But the problem is, if you are going perpendicular, there is a chance of injury to the aorta or vena cava or bowel. Going towards anus has four advantages. First advantage, any time in your life, you will not damage the aorta or vena cava. Because aortoiliac axis is 5 cm above the sacral promontory. Aorta is bifurcating into common iliac vessel. So if I am pointing towards the anus, then I am nowhere above the aorta or vena cava. So there is no question of injuring the great vessels. Other advantage is, due to hollow sacral curve, there is more space in the pelvis. Third advantage is, the sacral vertebra doesn't have the vertebral body elevated. in sacral vertebra, the body of the vertebra is in the same surface level of a transverse process, isn't it? Whereas in the lumbar and thoracic, it is elevated up, so it gives counter. But in the sacral vertebra, it is like that.
Yeah.
So curved, so it will be dimpled. If your breast will touch also, it will not injure. And the fourth advantage is that lower abdomen of everyone is lax, so it can be lifted up. So if you are pointing towards the anus, just asking the assistant to lift the abdomen, you can add extra space there. Lower abdomen is lax, and especially in multipara female it is very lax. But even in the male also it is lax. Upper abdomen cannot be lax. Why our lower abdomen is lax? Because we are erect. And once the human become erect due to the gravity, bobble is keeping the lower abdomen lax. So that's why it should be pointed towards the anus. But the problem is how to prevent the preperitoneal axis. To prevent it, you should lift the abdominal wall in such a way that the angle between the varus handle and the abdominal wall should be 90 degrees. But the angle between the body of the patient and the varus handle should be 45 degrees. So your both the problems are solved. Because if you will lift the abdominal wall like that, then angle between the varus handle and skin is 90 degrees. So it will not slide on the preperitoneum. Isn't it? And angle between the varus handle and real patient is 45 degrees. So it will not go towards the aorta also. So lifting the abdominal wall is most important part to prevent the injury. And even the surgeon who do the blind trocar insertion, they lift it. Lifting gives a lot of advantage. So I will just show you how it looks like even if you are doing the blind trocar insertion. So like here, this is just this is the way how we should hold the varus handle, like a dart. Pulp of three finger and thumb should oppose each other. The spring action and patency test also should be checked. Give a small incision over the inferior crease of umbilicus and then you hold it, lift the abdominal wall, full thickness abdominal wall, and then you should go. So angle between the varus handle and abdominal wall is 90 degrees, but angle between the varus handle and the body of the patient is 45 degrees. And then you will enter. This is the way. You should take two Aries forceps around the umbilicus. Detail about this I will discuss in access technique. That is a separate chapter. Right now I am just discussing for the point of instrument. So now this is the varus handle. Lift the abdominal wall. And angle between the varus handle and abdominal wall here, this angle is 90 degrees. But this angle will be 45 degrees. And then one click and two click, you are in. Some people who are doing the blind trocar insertion, they also do the same way. So just I would like to show you. This presentation I will discuss later in detail here. This is the blind trocar insertion. Here in this patient there is no pneumoperitoneum. And patient is abdomen is scaphoid without gas. And this is blind trocar. But lifting abdominal wall is a great value. So, index finger should be pointed towards the sharp end. Middle finger should wrap around and lift the abdominal wall. Ask your assistant also to help it. And then, angle of this trocar should be towards the anus. So, you will point it towards the anus here. Like this. This angle is 90 degrees, but this angle is 45 degrees. And then you will rotate it. Right, left, right, left. Never ever in your life you can damage aorta or vena cava with this. Either you go by varus handle or trocar. Slowly, 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 slowly you will enter and it is inside the abdomen. So always point towards the anus. But there are three exceptions of oblique entry. In three group of the patient, you should not go oblique, you should go perpendicular. First is any lower midline incision. Suppose any laparotomy was done with the midline incision, then we should not point our varus needle or trocar towards the anus, because there may be potential risk of adhesion and we can pierce the varus needle into the bowel. Second exception is that if the patient has morbid obesity, in morbid obesity, if you go oblique, you will be lost anywhere into the fat pad itself. So you have to go perpendicular. And in morbid obesity, even going perpendicular is not a problem, because umbilicus is displaced down. With increasing obesity, umbilicus is no more just above the aortoiliac axis, it goes down. Once the BMI becomes 45, then umbilicus comes at a level of anterior superior iliac spine. And once the BMI is 55 or 60, that is super morbid obese patient, then umbilicus goes up to the level of scrotum. That's why in WWF sumo, you are seeing that they are holding their umbilicus with the cloth and then tying it on the buttock. Otherwise, their umbilicus will touch the floor. So those patients, if they come to you, you have to put supraumbilical cord. Through the umbilical, you cannot enter into the abdomen. So what I am telling you, in obese patient, you should must go perpendicular. And third exception is diagnostic laparoscopy under local anesthesia. In local anesthesia, if we will go oblique, we will be lost somewhere and patient will cry, because we cannot anesthetize the complete oblique pathway of entry. So we have to do filled block around the umbilicus. So to prevent the pain of the patient, you have to go perpendicular. So these are three exceptions where oblique entry should be avoided. But remember, whenever you are going oblique towards the anus, actually it should be perpendicular to the abdominal wall. So lifting the abdominal wall is very important, and for that good amount of muscle relaxant should be given. Sometimes our anesthetists, what they do, they keep the patient initially light, and then you cannot lift the abdominal wall nicely. In open surgery, maximum relaxation is required when you are performing the procedure. But in laparoscopy, maximum relaxation is required at the time of access, at the time of introduction of varus needle and trocar. So if you think that abdominal wall is still tight, you should request your anesthetist to give some more muscle relaxant, and then it will help you to put the varus needle in appropriate place.
Sir, he says they are using epidural.
Epidural anesthesia in laparoscopy should be only limited for a small procedure or retroperitoneal surgery, like the totally extraperitoneal hernia surgery. Wherever you are doing intraperitoneal access, epidural ideally should be avoided. Do you know why? Because patient will never be quiet on the table. I will tell you, you are from Uttarakhand. In Roorkee District Hospital, Harish Rawat has taken me many times, who is going to be Chief Minister now this time in your state. So for performing the surgery there and to train the surgeons, he requested, I went. And every surgery, they were performing under epidural. So you will be surprised, patient, they were doing like that, because it irritates the diaphragm. And they have pain, they will keep on, and there is a vocal anesthesia. Just 5 minutes, it's going to be over, please tolerate. Isn't it? So it is, because you cannot sedate the patient. Patient is not intubated also. Isn't it? Posture also, you have to limitation in changing. Gas, you cannot put more than 12 millimeter of mercury. Otherwise, it will decrease the minute volume and tidal volume of the patient. And CO2 irritates the diaphragm. So if it is rural area, it is okay. But in metro, your patient will sue you. Isn't it? During throughout the surgery, I was having the extreme pain, and I was completely restless and surgeon was still continuing the surgery. So ideally epidural anesthesia should be limited for simple diagnostic procedure or tubal patency test. Within few minutes it's done, or ovarian drilling, little bit tubal, these procedures, or extrapatorial surgery, like totally extrapatorial hernia, because in that the gas will be in the preperitoneum, it is not going into the abdominal cavity, so it is not pressing the diaphragm, it is not pressing the vena cava, and it is not having any chances of irritation. So, but of course, people they do because of the cost effectiveness and safety. Epidural is safe, but don't do the bigger procedure. And especially patient can afford, then we should must give the general anesthesia. So this was regarding the.
So when we are inserting the varies needle, there are two click sounds. So
two click sounds.
And the first.
First is rectus. Second is peritoneum. Around the umbilicus, posterior and rectus is making single seat. So you will not get anterior and posterior separate.
So the first click sound is because of the pierce.
Both the click sound. Both the click sound is due to this spring.
Spring action.
Yes. So first is due to the rectus, this, and second is due to peritoneum. And you know, before penetrating the peritoneum, actually there is a 4 cm tenting. If you will see the varus needle, how it enters, then the first here, this is the varus needle going, first it will tent the peritoneum, like this. And then it will pierce. If you see, this is tenting. Peritoneum and skin, these two structures in our abdominal wall is plastic structure. Rectus, muscle, fat, they are elastic. It gives you weight. It has fibers. But skin has to be punctured and peritoneum has to be punctured. So it is tenting 4 cm and then it will puncture like that. And now this blunt tip will come in front and this is the varus needle. So
the
advantage of... Yes, spring action. And advantage of blunt tip is that even it will touch the bobbin, it is not perforating. But ideally, the direction should be towards the anus. Here, this is correct direction. And then you can perform it like that. So, this was regarding the varus needle. Now, the varus needle, what are the parts? This is for connecting the gas. As soon as you go in, you should connect one syringe and then you should do the irrigation test. You irrigate it. If you irrigate it, it should go freely. If it is going freely, that means it is good. Then you aspirate. Well, after irrigation, this is irrigated, then you aspirate. Once you will aspirate, nothing should come. The fluid which you have irrigated, if it is coming back, that means we are not into the abdominal cavity. Either we are in muscle or in the rectus or in the preperitoneum, isn't it? So this way it will create the problem. And third important thing which you have to keep in mind, that when you are irrigating and aspirating, if more fluid comes, what you have irrigated, that means either we are in bladder or patient had ascites. If the red comes, that means we are in vessel, or if yellow dribbling it comes, that means it is bobbin. Sometime in cases of ruptured appendix and all, you will see typical astrocyte started coming and you will know at that time only that there is perforation. So this aspiration is very good. After that you have to do hanging drop test. Open it and put few drop of saline there, here. And this is hanging drop. This drop was hanging. And then due to the negative pressure inside the abdominal cavity, this is hanging drop. And once you will pull it, automatically it will suck in. So that gives you the confirmation that you are inside the abdominal cavity. Sometimes the people who don't like hanging drop, you can do plunger test or piston test. What is piston test? I will just show you. That sometime if you are doing sleeve gastrectomy or if you are doing all, these procedures here. So you can do the piston test. Here you can see this is the incision has been given. Now the varus will be introduced. And because of the lot of fat, if you have any problem, this is a varus needle. Check the spring action, check the patency test. And because it is obese patient, so it will go perpendicular to the abdominal wall. You can see one click, this is second click, and then you can put the and remove the piston out. And see now, this is collapsed, and now all the fluid will be sucked in. Can you see that? This is called as piston test or plunger test. That is one of the very much confirmatory sign. Because hanging drop test, when you are putting couple of drop of saline, here this is hanging, sometimes it gives you false positive, false negative. That it may get sucked or it may not get. So if you do the piston test, you hold it like that and take it out. And then you will see this column is going down. Can you see that? And that will make you the confirmation of the intraabdominal access. So, and last is quadromanometric indicator. Means once you will attach with the gas will give you the reading about the, there is some relation that I will discuss during insufflated. So, this is the way how we have to make it that we are in correct place. So, irrigation test, suction test, hanging drop test. And then you will know that you are in. Now, question is, second question is, what is the usage of the varus needle? First was the name and the function. Now, what are the uses? First use is creating pneumoperitoneum. Second use is that it is a beautiful instrument for two port surgery, for cholecystectomy, for appendicectomy, and you can use it as a port closure instrument also. Yes, for closing the port, or sometime for ventral hernia surgery with a suture without tacker. So how to do that? You will remove it and keep the stylet away. The stylet will be away. And use the needle and then introduce the suture into the needle. Here is the needle and you put the suture inside the needle like this. And you will go put in, and once it will go in, you should use either PDS or proline or catgut also. And here it is in. Now it will come to the other side. And once it goes in, here, okay, this is like that, and then tie a knot. Tie a knot here. Simple knot, just a square knot. And then cut it. Extra suture you will cut. It is cut. After that, hide it. This is hidden. Now it is a beautiful port closure instrument. If you have to close the port, 10 mm wound, then what you do, take the other suture, and just feed 1 cm of this suture in, like this. Here.
Without needle, other one?
Pardon?
Other one without needle?
Suture. Without needle, just a tie. And then bend it. And hold like a dart. And suppose this is the cannula already in. Cannula tocar also. If tocar is in, don't remove the cannula. Transfer the telescope to the other port. And then you go oblique, leaving the skin and taking rest of the layer. You are in. After that, put your finger on the thread, which is straight, and pull the varus needle out. Varus needle is out, the thread is
inside.
And then you go from other side without the thread and just entangle it here. Beautifully it will get entangled here. Can you see that? Now it is entangled. And then you pull it out. Both the ends are out. remove the cannula and tie a knot. Your port is closed. Is it clear? So idea is that it is used just by a cobblers, shoemakers. You know, they pull the thread with the thread.
You cannot do this without the first suture inside.
You cannot do this
without threading this loop, making this loop.
No, because this loop is entangling the suture inside. I will show you again.
Yeah.
I will show you again without cannula.
I got the point.
Yes, you have to feed it 1 centimeter inside, like this, like that. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Then bend it. White and spherical. And then you go from one side and you are in. And put the thumb over the long thread. Here, this is the longer one. And rotate and pull. What happened? Thread is left inside. And from other end of the wound go. And as soon as you will pull it, a bow will form. Can you see that? And in that you have to just entangle this one here. And it will be very easy. Sometime here, it is done. See here now. It is out. And both the end are out. Both the end is here. If you have a 210 mm, then feed in one cannula and then don't tie it. Transfer the telescope from here to there. And then again feed into the other cannula and at the end tie both. So we will practice it also.
That room is still there, no?
The room is still there. Still there. Sometime it can be used for appendicectomy. Do you know what we do? We put it into the right iliac fossa or right hypochondrium. And then it is in. Then you go with one grass pad. Catch the appendix and pull it out. Now the needle is out. And then rotate it. And once you will rotate, it will act as a contraction. And now appendix can be pulled up like that. You got it? So without any grasper, you can use it as a grasper. Sometimes we use for single incision cholecystectomy. And it is used for ventral hernia to fix the corner suture of the mesh with the abdominal wall. So this has a lot of other functions also in spite of this access. Pneumoperitoneum is the first primary use, but you can use it for the other purposes. Sometime it can be used for aspiration also. Like you can use it for ovarian cysts to aspirate. Or gallbladder. Sometimes it is used for cholangiogram also. If you want, you don't have the cholangiogram and ureteric catheter directly, you can inject it. So these are the simple use. Now, next question is, what is alternative of the venous needle? Only alternative of the venous needle is open access. And for open access, you have to use Hessian cannula. This is Hessian trocar and Hessian cannula. This is Hessian trocar, which is a blunt trocar. And this is Hessian cannula sleeve, that is a conical sleeve. And you can put it over any cannula. Here you can put it and you can screw it. And now this becomes the Hessian trocar, which is conical. Hessian technique is layer by layer technique, where you have to open in the layers. And that is important when you perform it. And how to do, I will just demonstrate you. You take and you give one transverse incision below the umbilicus. After that, you take two stay suture over the rectus. One towards you, other towards your assistant. Pull it. Once you will pull it, the rectus will stand like a bridge. So a skin was cut transverse, but rectus will cut longitudinal along the line of linea alba. And you should cut only rectus, no peritoneum. And after that, either you will use seizures or the mosquito forceps. And just like the bird which dig the tree, you will dilate it. And slowly, slowly, you will open it and enter inside the abdominal cavity. So here it is under vision. Two retractors are there. It is under vision. Now this is one suture. The same suture which you were using for rectus to hold, same suture will be used to stabilize the cannula. Because this is conical. So conical shape, why they make it conical? Because it is just like a mini laparotomy. And it will never be 10 mm. Sometime 10, 11, 12, 13. It can vary according to the thickness of abdominal wall. If more fat is there, wound become bigger. So conical shape will fix it even if it is big wound. And the same stay suture will be fixed to stabilize it. And at the end of the surgery, same stay suture will be used to close the wound, close the port. So this is the Hassan technique which is used. Hassan technique has a great advantage, especially if you are expecting any intra-abdominal adhesion. Because in those situations, you can feel it by the finger and then you can easily examine it. So the advantage will be that so this is finger also. So sometimes you can put your finger and if there is any adhesion, you can break it or you can feel it all around. If you will discuss or if you will do a debate on the Hassan technique versus Verismil technique, most of the people are agree that Hassan's technique is better. As far as the bowel injury is concerned, it is only slightly superior than the Verismil technique. But as far as the vessel injury is concerned, it is far superior than the Verismil technique. Because in Hassan technique, you can never expect to perforate aorta or vena cava. Whereas Verismil technique, we never know. Blind is blind and sometimes injury can happen. So this is the how the finger can feel. And these are the two stay sutures now. And you can pull it out and you can keep it here. These are two stay sutures. And now this is a Hassan cannula. And it will be fixed. And then you can tie it around. So that's why there is a sleeve here. There is two ties. There is one. Can you see that? So that you can like tie it and it will be stabilized properly. And trocar is blunt because once you have the wound, then you have to drop the Hassan cannula and trocar into that. So this was regarding the substitution. If you don't have the Verismil, then either open technique or some people they do blind trocar insertion. But open technique is always better. Now the next question is, what are the complications it can do? Of course, it can rupture any organ, it can damage the bowel, it can injure the vessels. So it is obvious. Now the next question is, how to clean and sterilize? In laparoscopic surgery, our instruments are never sterilized. Unless you use the disposable. Only guarantee of sterilization is if you use the disposable. Because they are gamma sterilized. In laparoscopy, if you want to sterilize, you have to autoclave. And autoclaving is difficult because every instrument has to be wrapped separately. And care should be taken that insulation should not break. Because if one instrument will hit another, then insulation will be breached. Insulation will crack one instrument. And if the insulation is broken, it is a big danger of burn of the bowel. It can create the injury. So you have to put the polythene wrap around the every instrument. And then you can autoclave. Next method is ethylene oxide chamber, in which you need 55 degrees centigrade for 20 minutes or half an hour in ethylene oxide chamber, then it will be sterilized. Next method of sterilizing is gamma chamber. But you know, if you will put gamma chamber or plasma chamber to sterilize, the cost of instrument will be more than the disposable. So generally what the people they do, for cost effectiveness, they use chemical sterilization. And that is not sterilization, that is called as disinfection. And the first chemical which was used is glutaldehyde. That is 2% glutaldehyde. And this comes in the pack like that. Popular brand name is Cydex. Cydex is from Johnson & Johnson, Ethicon. But in India, different brands are there, like Gluteride, Glutehel, more than 20 companies are making this. Now you have to open it, and then you need to mix it here. That is called as activated. And once it is activated, then you have to write it on the Cydex tray. There is one Cydex tray. In the Cydex tray, you will write the activation date and expiration date. And it is 15 day or 15 time. If you see here, there is one record date here. In a small piece of paper, you have to stick activation date and expiration date. It is either 15 time or 15 days. So if suppose inside, if you will see, there is one perforated tray here. It has holes there. So this will be inside, and then you will put this 5 liter Cydex solution and then keep all the instrument inside. You know, disinfection time is 20 minutes to half an hour. And it is the best known virus neutral agent. For virus, it is fantastic. Even patient has HIV or hepatitis B, the Cydex kills those viruses very soon. Within minutes, within seconds. Now, it is a good bactericidal. Bacteria will be killed within 20 minutes to 30 minutes. But it is a bad sporicidal. For a spore, if you want to kill, 6 to 8 hours contact time is required. Then only it will be called as sterilized. But unfortunately, in most of the hospital, they within 20 minutes they take it out. Because if you don't have 2, 3, 4 set of instrument, and if it is high volume hospital, in the same day they have to perform 4, 5 surgery, then by the time the patient is changed, they put in the Cydex, and then once the patient is again anesthetized, they take in the Cydex and do it. That's why recently a spore producing port wood infection is, especially atypical mycobacterial infection is very much prevalent. Do you know why? And sometimes Pseudomonas and sometimes other infection.
So because why is atypical mycobacteria is the most common organism? Why specifically?
One of the common cause of that is called as weeping umbilicus. Sometimes what happens that umbilicus keep on weeping. Initial infection you will give some antibiotics and all. But after that, even after maybe 6 months or 1 year, patient will complain that whenever she go to the washroom and press the umbilicus, some fluid comes out. And in those situations, if you get the complete cytological or culture sensitivity, then it can be atypical mycobacteria. And to treat that, you have to give a lot of clarithromycin also, high dose, isn't it? And food drug, and that also takes a lot of long duration time too. So that happens due to the improper disinfection. So ideally, 6 to 8 hour time you should give.
How to activate, what else is to be added to the
glutaldehyde? Already in the bottle, activator will be there. And activator is actually glutaldehyde. The fluid is just a saline, yes. So once you will add it, then it is concentration is made. And after activation, either you have to use within 15 days or 15 surgery.
Just by putting in this, it will be activated?
Yes, and then you don't have to change it.
For 15 days?
15 days. Or in other, if in 3 days only you have done 15 surgery, then you will discard it. Or within 15 days there was no surgery, then also you have to throw it. Now, it has to be covered also. Pores are very important. Do you know why? When suppose time is over, contact time, then you will lift it and all the glutaldehyde will go down. Now you should have another tray with a saline and you will dip it 2-3 times. so that excess of the rooted hair will be rinsed out, isn't it? So otherwise, directly the rooted hair, if it is dropped, then it can enter into the abdominal cavity. Although it is not poisonous, but it is irritant. Yes.
Sometimes I see just the grave with ghosts, images and sedates, not
the mouse.
They wrap it with a piece of gauze. You know, it is recommended that even a handle, portion of handle also should not be out from the fluid. It should be completely immersed into the fluid.
It is immersed, but to avoid a contact between the instruments, they usually...
The towel is soaked.
Contact is, there will be no big problem of the contact in the tray. You know why? Because only thing is, you should not use gilet first. If you want to remove or if you want to drop, you should use a sterile gloves hand. And then you can take it out. If you want, suppose the cytex is costlier, or if you have the problem with the cytex, or then you can use formalin chamber. In the formalin chamber, some people they use formalin chamber for primary disinfection also. They keep the instrument overnight in the formalin chamber and morning they do surgery. So they keep it 12 hours in formalin. But ideally, formalin chamber should only be used for keeping the instrument sterilized. So your nurse will open and with the gloves hand you can take it out. And these are the formalin tablets. These tablets are should be moist, and at least 6 to 8 tablets you will keep it. And once the tablet is in the tablet form, it is good. But once the potency of this tablet will go, it will become powder.
Which is better, sir, Cydex or this?
No, Cydex is always better. This is just for the freelancer.
Okay.
Who want to perform surgery from one hospital to another, they can carry instrument. Or to keep the camera head or the cables. Isn't it? These cables. But you should not use it for primary disinfection of your dissector and all. So, suppose you have put in the Cytex, and after Cytex surgery is postponed, then you can keep it in the formalin chamber. So that, this is formalin tablets, which you can use it. Now, tablets generally last for 1 week. 6 tablets, 1 week it will last. Although, it also depends upon the temperature of your OT, and how frequently you are opening the door. In summer season, tablets get powdered within few days. And suppose you are frequently opening the door, humidity will be lost and it will evaporize much quicker. So generally, these are the two methods. But problem of the Cytex is, one problem, it is time taking. For proper sterilization, it takes 6 to 8 hours. Other problem is, it is carcinogenic. So if repeatedly a skin is exposed, it is not good. Proper gloves should be used. For patient it is not a problem, because patient is exposed only one time. But your paramedical is exposed every day.
So the Cytex is carcinogenic or?
Yes. Yeah. Now to prevent this problem, nowadays new generation chemicals are there. Those contain biguanides and paraphthalmitides. These are very good because within 30 minutes it is sporicidal also. It kills a spore also within 20 to 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. The Ethicon is selling by the name of OPA or Rapicytex. And other company like this is Elderly Pharmaceutical. They are making by the name of Medis. And different companies are there which make it. If you will read here, it is virucidal within 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Bactericidal within 10 minutes.
Bactericidal also 10 minutes.
Immunocompromised protection 30 minutes.
HIV 30 minutes.
Exposable 30 minutes.
Yes, spore also 30 minutes.
And tuberosal protection 30 minutes.
Even the tuberculosis also 30 minutes. So it is very good. It is not carcinogenic. It has a little detergent action also. So you should take care that it should be, when you are lifting it carefully, otherwise it can slip from your hand. Telescope can break.
So how much solution should be taken?
Pardon?
How much of
should be immersed?
You have to mix this complete bottle with 4.5 liter of normal saline. And then it will be also 15 time or 15 use. It will be activated. So these are the new generation chemicals.
How long it lasts?
15 time or 15 days. But here also in the bottle, if you will see very carefully, on the top it is written, what it is written? High level disinfectant. It is not written sterilizing solution. Because chemical sterilization is never guaranteed. You know, because of many reasons it may not work. Sometime if the handle is out, it is not completely immersed, or sometime it is exposed to a lot of bacteria, then it is never guaranteed.
Cost of one puffer bottle?
Pardon?
What is the cost of one puffer bottle?
The Cydex cost is one bottle of Cydex, means 5 liters of Cydex, will cost you 600 to 700 rupees. This will cost you approximately 1500 rupees. That is approximately 3 times costlier than the Cydex.
So in this regard of using septic, is it a guaranteed one must use like a prophylactic antibiotic in laparoscopic surgery?
You know, tomorrow I am going to discuss advantage and disadvantage of laparoscopy. Instead of that much abuse of sterilization, thanks to laparoscopy that infection doesn't happen. If these chemicals you will use in open surgery, all the patients will have infection. In laparoscopy, it has its own advantage and a lot of changes in physiology that infection generally doesn't happen. So, these are the, you know, if you are using disposable, it is always good. But remember one thing, if you are rich, you should use disposable. If you are poor, you should use reusable. But if you are using disposable as reusable, that means you are very poor. Some people, they use disposable and they use the disposable many times. That is very bad. Because disposable instruments cannot be dismantled. It cannot be properly cleaned also, and it cannot properly sterilize also. Because they don't give you the channels for sterilization. So it becomes always dirty. So after one use only, we should break and throw it. Anyway,
sir, what's
now,
the ideal way to sterilize the camera head?
Camera head, generally you should avoid sterilizing. You should use the sterile sleeve. You should use a sterile sleeve. This is a sterile sleeve. So it is already sterilized, and then you will open and drop the camera and it will make a seat all around the wire. Even the light cable. You know, most of the now new generation cameras, they are soakable and autoclavable. A striker, a star, you can autoclave, soakable. But nobody does like that. Because if the temperature is little increased and if you get melted, then company will not tell that, they will say that, no sir, you might not have maintained the proper pressure, proper temperature. So generally, we don't want to take the risk.
It should not be kept in the formalin chamber also.
Formalin chamber has the problem, sometimes the crystals get precipitated over the lens and then it becomes hazy. So generally it is better to use the sterile sleeve. And it is not expensive. But if you want that expense also not to be there, then you can use the, cloth, yes. You can make your own. And then you can use it. So, just let me see, I can show you. So what we do, we prepare our own. Like, so, see here. Can you see this cloth? Here this is?
Disposable.
See here, in the camera, it is a complete same cloth which you are using your gown. You can attach it there. So that can give you. I will show you later also, and in the OT also I will show you. So you can make your own here. Can you see this cloth?
Yes.
Here, it is. So it is inexpensive. And you can autoclave with your gown. You can autoclave it, make a tubular pipe of the cloth, and then you can use it. Only problem is if it is wet, then it is a problem because bacteria can transfer. But in polypropylene, there will be no transfer of bacteria. So, generally, camera head you should avoid autoclaving or putting in the chemical also. Now, next instrument which I am going to discuss is trocar. Basically, it is port. You have two type of port. This is 10 mm. This is 5 mm port. But synonym is, we say that this is trocar. But trocar is only this one. So then ask you to trocar, give this also. Keep it with you. And this is cannula. If you will put both together, it will call as port. Port means pathway of entry and exit. Now, trocar has many varieties. You have conical trocar, pyramidal shaped trocar, safety trocar, blunt trocar, all trocars are. This is pyramidal shaped trocar, which is very popular and maximally used. It is like a pyramid. So that advantage is once you rotate it, it spreads the fibers away. So you hold it and once you are rotating, automatically it goes in. Another one is conical. Conical trocars are conical shape. Conical trocar. This is conical. So it doesn't have pyramid, it is soft. But the problem is, in this trocar you have to apply little more force. Rotation will not work here. Because rotation already it is smooth, like a pencil tip. Isn't it? Then you have safety trocar. In the safety trocar, this is safety trocar. In safety trocar, just like Veres drill, the blunt tip comes in and out when you press. But remember, safety is wrong term here. It is not 100% safe. And the amount of force required here is more than the sharp trocar. Then you have the blunt trocar. Blunt trocar already used in the Hassan Kerala. Sometimes question is asked that which trocar is more safe, blunt or the sharp? Suppose you have two pyramidal shapes, one is little old and one is very new, sharp. Which one is safer?
Sure.
The sharper is safer. This because part. Sharper your trocar is, less force is required to enter. And then it is safe. If it is blunt, more force is required to enter.
Does the rotation of the sharp?
Yes.
To my knowledge, we didn't need to rotate because it cuts while it is going. So to
no,
make like this,
that is in the disposable. In the disposable, there is a bladed trocar. There is a blade.
Yeah.
So in disposable, if you will rotate, it will get discharged in the halfway. Disposable, I am going to demonstrate you. In disposable, you should never rotate. But here in the reusable pyramidal trocar, you must rotate it. How to hold it? The head of the trocar should rest over the thin air eminence. Middle finger should wrap around the air inlet. And index finger should be pointed towards the sharp end. This is a way to hold the trocar, like a piston. Middle finger should wrap around the air inlet. Head of the trocar should rest over thin air eminence. This is thin air eminence. Head of the trocar. And index finger should be pointed towards the sharp end. This is the way of holding the trocar. And this is the only way of holding the trocar. If you will hold the trocar properly, Here, you see the way of holding the trocar. And you know, in the cannula, there are two type of finishing. This is dull and this is shiny. This is dull. Half of the cannula is dull, half is shiny. Why this is dull? So that it will not reflect the light. And your index fingers will reach halfway. Middle fingers will wrap around the ear inlet. And head of the trocar should rest over the finale eminence. And after that, incision is already 11 mm. It should not be 10 mm because outer diameter is 11 mm. And then you should take your time, keep on rotating. And by right and left movement, slowly you will enter inside. You know, most of the time injury is happening due to momentum. And momentum is mass into velocity. Sometimes what happens, that we push it harder. And then we cannot control the velocity. Our abrupt, inadvertent, high speed entry into the abdominal cavity, even if the barbell is touched, it will immediately get injured. Because if the speed is more, it will, but if the speed is less, it will remove the barbell away. Just like the judo, karate or taekwondo, with the finger only they can break the brick. Why? Because the speed is high. Volume is not much. Mass is less, but just like bullet can penetrate because of the speed. Although the tip of the bullet is blunt, but it can penetrate. Exactly same way, never try to increase the speed of your entry. And a smooth entry needs that you should hold the trocar. If you will not put the thinar eminence here, then the trocar will come back. Isn't it? Like this. And now you are struggling with the blunt tip. So your thinar eminence and middle finger should press each other. Here. Thinar eminence and middle finger is pressing each other. So that tip will not come back. And then index finger should be pointed towards the sharp end. And then slowly you will keep on rotating. And here it enters. Advantage of index finger is it will stop you inadvertently going fully in. Isn't it? Some people they hold this way. This way you should not hold. Because fear is that you can go fully in. So always keep index finger pointed towards a sharp end so that it can stop you going fully in.
Then middle finger should be opposite.
Each other. The middle finger and the head of the trocar thinar eminence should press each other so that it will, yes, this and this should press each other. Did it? Here. So that it will not come back. Suppose you will not support it here, then it goes in like this. And then you are struggling with the blunt cannula. So that's why it should be opposed to each other. And then you should go rotating. Remember, most common cause of forceful entry is a small skin incision. Rectus, fat, they never hold you. What is holding is the skin. Sometimes what happens that we want to become more cosmetic. And our skin incision was only 9 mm or only 10 mm. And then when you are going, the margin of the dry skin will get inverted. And once it is inverted, it is making a very tight hold over your cannula. And now you are pushing. You more push, more get inverted. And then it is not going and you are in trouble. So remember, whenever your cannula is not going smoothly, take it out and enlarge the skin incision. Because most common cause of forceful entry is a small skin incision. A skin incision actually should be 11 mm or little more. Because outer diameter is 11 mm. Sometimes in the beginners, if you have a problem that what is 11 mm, what is 12 mm, then you remove the trocar and just with the cannula you put it over the head like this. You see that? And will give you automatically on the skin of the patient, you will get a mark and then cut it that much. So that it will give you the exact, it will not leak also. If it is too big wounded, then also it's a problem. Gas will keep on leaking by the side. And if it is too small, then also it is a problem. So just you can give a mark like that and then you can cut it accordingly. After some time, you will have experience, you don't need to do it. So in trocar there are two things. One is tip, other is there is one eye at the tip. If you see here, there is one opening here. There is a hole there. Can you see this? There is an opening here. Why do you know? This eye is communication with the back. In the back there is one hole. And this eye, it gives you whooshing sound. They like this sound. What happens? As soon as you enter with the trocar inside, the gas will leak from there through this eye. And it gives you this type of sound. And that is one of the confirmations that our trocar is in. Tip of the trocar has a small opening here. This is small opening here. And that is communicated here. And that is communicated by the back. These trocars are not solid, these are cylindrical. Now, cannula. Cannula has two parts. One is valve, another is shaft. Here, this is valve of the cannula. This is valve. And this is shaft. In valve, there are two types of valve. One is flap valve. Sometimes you have magnetic valve. Here, this is flap valve. You see? This is flap valve. This is flap valve. So it is just like a flap. And here it is giving you rubber like sound. Do you know why? If you see here, there is a rubber seal here. Just like in the pressure cooker, there is a rubber seal which holds the steam inside. In the pressure cooker, if the rubber seal is broken, will the steam hold? It will not hold. Exactly the same way, this is a rubber seal here. You see that? Yes. This is a rubber seal. And time to time you have to change this rubber seal. You know, sometimes your cannulas are leaking. And unnecessarily you are changing the cannula. It is not necessary to change. The cost of this rubber seal is just 10 rupees only the cost. And your nurse should know how to change the rubber seal. Or you should train her. Just it can be removed, a new rubber seal even. And how to know? It will give you rubbery sound. If rubber seal is broken, it will give you metallic sound. So if your cannula is there, once you come after scrubbing and once you have the gloves, then just before putting the trocar, couple of times, you should do like that. And if it gives you rubber-like sound, that means it is good. And if it gives you metallic sound, then you should not use that cannula. That means washer is broken. Yes, this is metallic sound. So, with the trocar, always metallic sound. Okay. Because, yes, you have to remove it. So, this way. Now, this will stop the gas leak once your instrument is not there. This valve has the action that function that once your instrument is not there, it will not allow the gas leak. Isn't it? So this is important. Now there are some of the valves are magnetic valve. Like this is magnetic valve. In this inside there is a magnet. If you see here this is a magnet. This is a magnetic valve. And if you see it will pull it. Here, once the instrument goes, it will push the magnet. One instrument comes out here, you see? It is magnet, it is sticking outside. And if you leave it, it goes in. So this is magnetic valve.
So it prevents the air leak during
exchange. Any valve has a function to prevent air leak. Now, we will discuss a little bit about air leak.
Is this metallic sound?
This is metallic sound.
So this is not
this will leak. Yes. And you know, once you are losing the pneumoperitoneum, then you have to find out where you are leaking. Now tell me, what are the possibility of leak? Where you can leak?
Why the incision?
So, okay, incision is big. One possibility of leak is incision is bigger. Second?
And the
destruction of the valve.
Okay. Third is valve is broken. Valve, washer is, rubber is broken. It gives you metallic sound. And heart?
This
valves are open. Trumpet valves.
Okay, that is that also you are correct.
High
that
pressure.
Your air vent is
pressure,
open.
Right.
Okay, four.
High pressure.
This ring.
Yes, this ring. This there is one washer on the top. See, it is broken. I have broken it. See here. This is broken here. Can you see?
Yeah.
It is broken. Right. So if it is broken, it is broken. See? And if it is broken, it will leak from here also. Now tell me how you will make it out, all these three leak. If valve is open, you will close it. You don't need to check it. If a skin incision is big, you have to put couple of drop of saline there and you will see bubble coming. Now how you will discriminate in between this washer and valve?
The instrument is inside.
If leak is with the instrument, then the washer is broken. If the leak happens after removing the instrument, that means inner valve is broken. Isn't it? Because once the instrument is in, suppose you will put an instrument, any instrument if you will put in, anyway this will open. Valve is open. So after putting the instrument, if gas is leaking, that means this washer is broken. And when instrument is not there, then this valve is keeping the gas in. So immediately you can make it out that where the leak is there. And in those situations, you open the valve and change the valve of other cannula. You may not need to take the trocar out. Only change the valve, it will start working. Or sometimes if the valve is bad and we don't have extra valve, we don't take the instrument out. We always keep the instrument hidden into the cannula. And if you have to take it out, put the thumb and then change it, which you might be doing sometimes the leak, put the thumb. But if you have a new cannula, you don't need to put any thumb there because the valve will automatically seal and there will be no gas leak.
Even after taking out the instrument, if it is leaking, then it is due to washer.
Yes. No. Not washer. After taking the instrument, if there is a leak, it is due to valve. But if you put the thumb any way, even the valve is open, gas will not come.
Okay.
Now,
if the skin is leaking,
yes, you can give a suture, but a skin leak only happens in very thin patient, cachexic patient. If patient is young and if patient is muscular, then even you know little skin big incision doesn't leak generally. Unless until elderly patient, very thin patient, because fat, muscle, fascia, all act as a bond there. Now, in the cannula and trocar, you have one eye at the tip here, in the cannula. Here, can you see? There is one hole there. Now, tell me why this eye is there. In the cannula, at the tip, there is one small opening. Why?
To prevent suction of viscera.
Bobble, yes. The purpose of this one is that sometimes the bobble is stuck there, then gas started going by the side. You know, sometimes if your valve is leaking, then it is not only a problem of losing the gas, it is a problem that sometimes omentum or bobble can get plugged into the cannula. And that will be risky because blindly if you are putting a suture, that can perforate. Suppose this omentum is plugged like that, isn't it? And especially if there is a leak, then sudden gust of the gas will bring the omentum to plug into the cannula. So advantage of this valve is if the tip of the cannula is plugged and then gas is going by the side, then further entry of the omentum will arrest. It will not go. So that's why every 10 mm cannula has one opening at the tip. In 5 mm generally they don't make it. So this was regarding the cannula and trocar. Now, next instrument which I am going to discuss is the disposable trocar and cannula. I will today only I will demonstrate disposable trocar and cannula. You know there are two giant companies in the world. One is Ethicon and other is AutoSwitcher. And whatever you will earn, they will take you from. They will take from you because 90% of the market of a disposable, these two companies are sharing. So the first disposable trocar which was used by the ethicon is called an endopath. This is endopath. Here you have to charge it. This is charge. And there is a blade inside. So you have to hold it and then you have to go in one go. Now it is discharged. As soon as you will go, it is discharged. So basically there is a blade there. If I will show you, there is a blade. Glass lavatory. Here, just let me show you that. Here, there is a blade. Can you see this blade? But it is, you have to do very carefully, otherwise it can cut your finger here. This is a little dangerous. Here is a blade. Can you see now? This is a blade here. So what happens actually, when you charge it, and let me show you very slowly if I can. See, this blade is out. Can you see that? And as soon as it goes in, blade goes again and blunt tip comes out. So it is just like a veracetal. And then it gets discharged. Once it is discharged, then blade will not come again. So you have to charge it. Charge it. And then you should not rotate it. Because if you rotate, in the half way it gets discharged. See, it got discharged. This is charge, this is discharge. This is charge, discharge. Charge, discharge. Why it is discharging? Because I am leaving the resistance. So what is recommended in the bladed trocard? That after charging, hold it and then you should go in one go. Because it goes by cutting action. There is a blade which cuts. So if you will not go in one go, suppose you are hesitant or rotating, then halfway it gets discharged.
But if I am speedy enough, I can make injury?
Yes, it can bleed sometimes. It can bleed sometimes, but generally we put our trocar in the place where there is no as such bleeder. Like you put inferior crease of umbilicus, so there is no bleeder unless until patient has portal hypertension, then the bleeder will be there, isn't it? This disposable, that's why what you are saying bleeding, they have changed it and recently they have launched the XL. In XL, this is XL. What they have done, that it is a bladeless trocar. And it has just like pyramidal shape, it has a pointed tip. And you can put a telescope also inside. So basically this is an optical trocar. And you can have a 5mm telescope. And if you want, you can put a 5mm telescope inside. And you know, you will hold it and while you are going, you have to rotate here. It will not go in one go. You have to rotate and then slowly it will go. And while you, because there is nothing to charge here. And while you are going, theoretically, you will keep on seeing all your passes. Like I will show you how it looks like. This is like this. This is like this. Here. If you see here, the starch has one optical needle. So various needle itself has a telescope. And if you will go layer by layer, layer by layer, you will see this is the fat and this is the peritoneum. And once you will cut the peritoneum, it will enter in the abdomen. So this is the optical trocar. And 5mm telescope, you can put it in. Telescope long? Yeah. And in the 10mm, you can put 10mm telescope in. But there is one problem. After putting the telescope, it will stuck your forearm. Once you rotate it, it will stuck your forearm. So then, how to put it? This is 5mm telescope. You have to drop it. And there is one lock. you will lock it. After that, it should not come out. It is fixed. And you will hold it and rotation, see, it is stuck in there. Isn't it? So, because head of the trocar, camera is also there. So, auto switcher has taken advantage of this demerit. And they have invented this VG-port. This is VG-port here. This is VG-port. VG-port, you don't have to rotate. Just put the telescope. And they have the pistol grip trocar and there is a blade in front. So just you go like that and press the abdominal valve and keep on firing. You will enter inside. Just you have to keep on firing. And this way, and theoretically, you can attach the camera head and you will see in your monitor all the layer one by one you go.
Then
so
this remove is, this?
Pardon?
Remove that part?
Yes, once it will go in, then remove the trocar and camera is there. In the camera, they have a universal reducer. So it can take from 5 to 12 mm, any size. So this is, if you see here, it is written 5 to 12. So even 5 mm instrument also gas will not leak. And even 12 mm, like endo-GIA, staplers, also you can put. So this is optical trocar. And that is very useful. But again, the cost effectiveness is a factor. Cost is 35,000 rupees for one trocar, Kerala, and it is single use. Single use, one time use. And remember, any of the article has not confirmed that using these trocar and Kerala absolutely can give you a risk free access. So, generally, our technique is important rather than the instrument. Because sometimes, if you will search on the Google, even with the VG port, aorta injury is reported. Because sometimes if you are directly dimpling the abdomen, there may be a problem. So these are the different type of, this is endopath and this is axial. Now, in the disposable also you have Hassan cannula. That is Hassan trocar and cannula is disposable. That also you can use if you want to do the open technique. So basically if you will see the difference, there is no difference in the disposable and reusable, except the disposables are lightweight, very soft in your hand, and especially if it is bladed one, it cuts very smoothly and enters. But keep one thing in mind, that if you will reuse this bladed one, sometimes tissue, fat or blood cell which enters may not take the blade back. And that is extremely dangerous. It can easily cut the bowel or it can injure. So that's why ideally if you are using it, it should be single use. But unfortunately, it is reused. In every hospital, they reuse it. And that's why now this bladed trocar, Ethicon is withdrawing. And now they give the bladeless trocar, so that you can rotate and you can enter. So that at least the blade will not cut or spring action will not stuck. So these are the different trocar and cannula. It is single use, so there is no question, but of course you can sterilize. If you want, you can sterilize. So this was regarding the different trocar and cannula. Now, you have some reducer. What is the reducer? Because you have two type of instrument. One is 10 mm and other is 5 mm. Can I have this 5 mm instrument? This is 5 mm cannula, 5 mm port. And other port you have the 10 mm port. This is 10 mm, this is 5 mm. Okay. So, generally we should use 5 mm. Now, I would like to ask you one question. Then how many ports are required for diagnostic laparoscopy?
One.
One?
One.
Yes, two should be there. Minimum. By definition, diagnostic laparoscopy, you know, definition of diagnostic laparoscopy is that diagnostic laparoscopy is visual examination and interpretation of intra-abdominal organ in order to detect any pathology by two ports. If you are using only one port, only telescope, that means it is vitreoscopy or it is stereoscopy. Do you know why? Because if the bowel is in the cul-de-sac, you cannot sweep it up. You cannot lift the ovary. You cannot lift the tube. Isn't it? You cannot lift the infundibulopelvic ligament. You cannot sweep the bowel to see the appendix. Appendix, 80% of the time, is hidden by the small bowel. And you are not supposed to go with the telescope to sweep it away. You should go by the instrument. So two ports must be there for diagnostic. Now question is, now the question is, how many minimum port is required for the operative? For operative, minimum three ports are required. With less than three ports, it should not be performed. Do you know, even if you are doing single incision laparoscopic surgery, you are using three ports. In the same incision, three instruments are going. So one is telescope, one is left hand retractor, another is right hand dissector, or sutures, or bipolar, harmonic, Maryland, whatever you want. So minimum three port is required. So that's why it is called a single incision laparoscopic surgery, not single port surgery. So with the single incision, sometime if we want to minimize, we can use some Stryker mini alligator percutaneous instrument. So that port will not be used, but minimum three instruments should be inside the abdomen. Now,
you mean if you did a procedure overtly by two instruments, result in injury or complications, they can sue you.
Yes.
Because you didn't use optimal ports.
Yes.
Isn't it? Because we can use tubal ligation, we can make it by two ports, single port.
Yeah.
We can make it.
For which surgery? For
tubal sterilization.
Tubal sterilization. Yes. Tubal sterilization, you can do by two ports also. One port will be telescope and another is following applicator. So, but normal operative procedure I am talking about, like cholecystectomy, appendicectomy.
No, I look for a medical legal issue. If I have complication with two port and operative procedure, they can blame me. Because you didn't have optimal ports to conduct safe surgery. Or it is not of medical legal issue.
No, it is not of medical legal importance. You know, now again I will ask one question. That if you are using three port for any operative surgery like LAVH or appendicectomy, how many should be the 5 mm and how many should be 10 mm?
1 10 mm, 2 5 mm.
What is your criteria? Why you told that? Suppose I have to appendicectomy. Then how many should be 10 mm, how many ports should be 5 mm?
According to the specimen, to the specimen, so the 10,
yes,
so then you have 10.
You know what is important? If you have to take anything out from the abdomen, and if you have to put anything into the abdomen, you need at least 1 10 mm. Like appendicectomy, appendix has to be taken out. Anything you cannot take out with the 5 mm. Because in the 5 mm, as soon as can I have any instrument here, as soon as you will open the jaw, it will not come out. Like head is going, and suppose you will hold it like this. Now it is stuck. It will not come out. So any extraction if you want to do, even simple biopsy if you want to take, you have to use 10 mm. Do you know, if you will try, one thing you can do, you can pull everything together. But that is not recommended because it can do the contamination of the wound. Isn't it? So, if you have to do simple ovarian drilling, you don't need any 10 mm. You use a beautiful 5 mm telescope and then you go tritome and drill it because you are not extracting anything out. If you want to do LAVH, then also you can do by 3 5 mm. Nowadays, very good 5 mm telescopes are there, HD telescopes. And you don't need any 10 mm because uterus will be removed through the vaginal route. isn't it? And in LAVH only you are doing upper two pedicle. So closure of vagina is also vaginally. Vault is also not closed from laparoscopic route. So even the needle also you don't have to drop. But if you are doing appendicectomy, cholecystectomy or simple biopsy, then at least one 10 mm is required. What suppose you don't have 5 mm telescope, then for appendicectomy, two 10 mm port is required. One for telescope, the other for? Some people, what they do rail rotting. What they do, yes. So they, telescope is there and they pull the grasper and push the appendix into the telescope and while taking the telescope out. But this is not good. It is many literature they have against this. You know why? When you are pushing it, this instrument anyway will take 5 mm. Because this is metal, it cannot compromise. So what is your effective caliber now? Only 5 mm. And when you are pushing and taking the telescope back, then you are not seeing the fluid from the appendix or fecal matter which is excusing and dropping in the abdominal cavity, or sometime it can break also. So ideally, if you have a 5 mm telescope, then you will put 5 mm telescope in other cannula and then put a claw forceps and then take the appendix through the umbilicus. But if you don't have 5 mm telescope, then ideally 2 10 mm ports should be used. One for telescope and another for extraction. So number of the port and the diameter depends upon tissue extraction is required or not required.
So in pediatric
appendicectomies, can we use 5 mm? No, even in that also 1 10 mm is required to remove it. Now remember, whenever you use 10 mm, you have to close the port. 5 mm ports are not necessary to close. If you will not close the 5 mm port, chances of the hernia is only 0.25%. If you will not close 10 mm port, then it is 0.5 to 2%. If you will not close 12 mm port, then this is 5 to 10%. And if you will not close 15 mm port, then this is 20%. So, sometime if you have used any 10 mm port for tissue retrieval, that means it is no more 10 mm. Suppose you have used endobag, or you are pulling the gallbladder, or you are taking the ovary with the big ovarian cyst, and you are pulling, then it is no more 10 mm because it is stretched. And if it is stretched, you must close it. Because it is no more 10 mm, if it is 12 mm, then 10% chances. If it is 15 mm, then 20% chances. So closure of the port is important. There are certain places where you cannot close. That we will discuss. There is one Scandinavian technique. In a Scandinavian technique, a Scandinavian surgeon, what they do, they go inside the abdomen through the inferior crease of umbilicus, and they dilate the obliterated vitreo-intestinal tract which was present in the fetal life and get obliterated in the adult. And then when you will go with the mosquito forceps dilate it and then you put the trocar there, you may not need to close the port in umbilicus. That is because it will spontaneously close. It acts as a valve-like action. And cell intelligence of that area has a spontaneous closure. That I will discuss during the access technique. So, okay. So, we chori then. So, this way, if you want tea break, you want?
Okay.
Pardon? Not what? Okay, I will just finish because today, first day, many people might be tired also, coming all the way. You know, I myself came in the morning today from Iran. In Tehran, there was one international Mediterranean conference. So I came in the morning today, only 3 o'clock in the morning. So anyway, so, and I came through the Qatar from Doha only. So, yes, maybe you also came today only?
No. We came today.
That is better, so that you can rest and then you can start. So what I was telling about?
Closing.
Correct?
Closing the trap.
Yes, that is important. So unnecessarily we should avoid making any tenement. So I will tell you that reducers can be used. If you want to make 10 mm into 5 mm, there are two types of reducers. This is called as long reducer, and this is called as top mounted reducer. This is top mounted reducer, and this is long reducer. Now tell me which one is good.
Long.
Pardon? This is top mount. Top mounted, it will hang like that. And whenever you want, you can put it like this. This is top mounted. And if you don't want, you want 10 mm instrument, remove it. It will wait for you. And this is long reducer. Which one is good?
Sharp.
Why?
So valve inside the valve. So
yes.
May not injure the.
So one way it is good.
Yes.
That if you want only for instrumentation, it is good. Because even if it is attached, gas will not leak. Because it is not bypassing the valve. But you know, it is less useful. It is not much useful. Most of the time, long reducers are useful. Suturing, knotting, tissue retriever, always long reducer can work. Like suppose you have to suture, then you will put the needle holder inside the long reducer and then catch the suture, this is suture, and then hide it inside the reducer. Now it is hidden. Needle is hidden. And then you go. And then you go inside and do the suturing knotting. Again to take it out, hide it into the reducer and bring it out. Because it is bypassing the valve, so any time your suture or needle will not get trapped by the
valve.
The top mounted reducer you cannot use for suturing knotting. Like if you see top mounted, and if you will go like that, it will trap. So it doesn't go. Can you see that? It is not going, needle is obstructing it. Now what you can do, see here, it is also trapped now with the valve. Now it is not coming out also. See, this is holding the needle holder, where suture is trapped by the valve. So now what you have to do, you have to open the valve. And once you will open the valve, inside you will see all the suture has, see, entangled with the valve. Isn't it? That's why it was not coming. So this is a bag, and here it is all is entangled with the valve. So it is not useful for suturing knotting or for tissue retrieval. And sometimes needle breaks. Sometimes there will be big problem, which is completely trapped. And you have to open the valve and everything will be messy. So always use the long reducers for these purposes.
The disposable 10 millimeter troker.
Pardon?
The 10 millimeter troker, disposable, have already...
Yes, auto, you are correct.
Auto reducer.
In 10 mm, reusable, disposable, they have a radial dilating troker, reducer. So it expands just like a wing of a bird.
This
it opens
not,
and it
not
goes.
Good.
Pardon?
Not good for suturing?
Yes, you can use directly without reducer, you can put the needle in.
But it will not wrap?
No, it will not wrap. Do you know why? They have a heart valve, I will show you. They have a heart valve like opening here. See?
This is the one?
Just like this side, gas goes. But this side, it will stops. Means one-sided only. Like a, means bicuspid valve in the heart. So see here, this is a bicuspid valve. Can you see this? So it doesn't go other side. This is rubber. So this doesn't hold the needle.
Will not?
No, it will not hold the needle. Because it is like that, so it isn't, and moreover it is rubber, so it is metal, but it is metal, in metal will trap the suture. Here it can easily go. So in the disposable you don't have this problem. Like here, if you want to put the needle directly in disposable, easily it will go like this. And easily it will come out also. See? Not holding at all. But cost is 6,000 rupees. Cost of disposable trocars are more than reusable. This you will get for 4,000. And you can use for 10 years. This you will get for 6,000. And you can use only one time. But of course these advantages are there. Because valves are good. You don't need to put reducer. Because if you will see here, they have the, see, radially dilating reducer. Can you see that? Just like the wing of a bird, it opens and closes. If you put the finger and you feel the how it dilates. Right now it is only 3 millimeters. Once 5 millimeter instrument
according
goes,
to the size it is.
According to the size of your instrument.
5 to 12 millimeters.
Up to 12 millimeters. Up to 12 millimeters it can go. You can just transfer to everyone. They can see that. So this way, but if you are using the reusable, then you need to use the 10 mm long reducer. Long reducer also can be used to take the biopsy or take the appendix. Suppose this is appendix and I have to take out. I don't want that it should contaminate the boat wound. Then I will go and I will long reducer. I will catch it slowly. And then I will pull it into the reducer, isn't it? And then I take everything out. So my appendix is inside. And then I can eject it out. Without reducer, I cannot take it. Why? It will be trapped by the wall. Here it is broken by the wall. And where is the appendix? It is in the wall. So these are the advantages of long reducer. But here it is trapped by the bone. But one thing should be taken care of. Another advantage is that long reducer doesn't do the gesture imprecision. What is gesture imprecision? That if you will put the port like that, and if your instruments are 5 mm, then this is called as gesture imprecision. Means it is loose. So sometimes when you are dissecting, it will give you overshooting. And that is called as gesture imprecision. Because only top is reduced, throughout this channel is big. So sometimes it will touch here, sometimes it will touch here. This is. But in long reducer, gesture imprecision is not there. So lever action is better. Lever action is better. So these are the advantages. Now sometimes you have sleeve over the cannula. Those sleeves are 5 mm as well as 10 mm sleeves. Here this is sleeve. And sometime over the cannula you have to attach the sleeve. Here this is a sleeve attached over the cannula. And if you want to remove, you can remove it. It is out. So tell me why this sleeve is required. What is the function of this sleeve?
To fix the trocar, not to go in or out.
You are correct. There may be one reason that it will not allow our cannula to slip frequently. It will not come out or it will not come go in because it gives resistance. But this is not the primary function.
There is leak.
Pardon?
There is leak.
That also you can use it. But that is also not a primary function. You know the primary function of these sleeves is totally extraperitoneal surgery. Totally extraperitoneal surgery. Retroperitoneal or extraperitoneal. Sometime if you are using the tape hernia, then you cannot use totally extraperitoneal hernia, then you cannot use the trocar. You have to use cannula only. Because if you use trocar, then can you enter into the preperitoneal? You cannot. Why? It will prick the peritoneum. So at that time you have to use this sleeve. What to do? Suppose this is This is what you give. You will give one incision to the skin, and then incision to the anterior rectus, and then sweep the finger, and then put the cannula directly, and keep on rotating. Now this cannula will slide over the posterior rectus, and we all know below the arcuate line, posterior rectus is continuous with the peritoneum. So you will enter into the extraperitoneal space. Just I will show you a little bit how it is done. One video so that you can go. So wherever you want to do any extraperitoneal surgery, you have to use it. So like totally extraperitoneal hernia surgery you want to do, and you have to do the access. Then here we make our own balloon by tying two gloves finger over the suction irrigation instrument, and then check it by 50 cc saline. After that, give an incision just below the umbilicus, and then cut the skin, then cut the anterior rectus, and then put this with the finger. You will do a little bit dilatation, and then put this balloon and fill it with the 50 cc saline so that a potential space is created. Now here is distension, and you can see this is the balloon dilatation of the space. And after 5 minutes, remove this cannula, and then you will use sleeve with the cannula, no trocar, no trocar. This is sleeve. Can you see this? Here, this is sleeve with the cannula without trocar. Rotate it, rotate it, rotate it, rotate it, and automatically it will slide over the posterior rectus and then through the peritoneum. And now telescope will go, and these are the fibrous trabeculis which will be visible. Secondary trocars, you can go with the trocar, but primary should only cannula should go without trocar. So this is a sleeve which you will use. Sometimes this sleeve is used for retroperitoneoscopy also, like the urologist who wants to do the retroperitoneoscopy, they will use it, and it is very useful. Like here, this is a thoracolumbar fascia which you have to break, and then you have the, in the sleeve itself we tie one gloves. Here you will see that this is the sleeve, and we put one finger of the gloves. It is finger of the gloves, and this is sleeve. And now with the sleeve, with the cannula, with the telescope, you will enter, and then you will inject the saline with the Medex pump, and once the saline will expand this gloves finger, it will be visible. Kidney will be visible, peritoneum will be visible. Keep it for 5 minutes, and then this is a sleeve and cannula and telescope. This is sleeve, this is cannula, and then you will bring everything together. Here it is out. So this is gloves, this is sleeve, this is cannula, this is telescope, and it is out. So this is the way how these sleeves are very useful, especially in extraperitoneal surgery. It will allow you to gradual progression of the cannula without puncturing the peritoneum. So if you want to do retroperitoneoscopy or totally extraperitoneal hernia surgery, then you should have it. Then only you can enter carefully. So this was regarding the trocar and cannula. Now next day, I will discuss all the other instruments like the seizures and the grasper.